This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we have one of the most remarkable stories I know. It is, in some respects, the most remarkable story of its kind that has ever been told. It starts with a flash of lightning and ends in another way of looking at reality. It's that big. We're talking to a dear friend of mine, Jeffrey Kripal, who is going to explain to us what is all this is about, and to another dear friend, Elizabeth Krohn, who it happened to, who will tell us firsthand what it was. Welcome, both of you, to Dreamland.
Well, thank you, Whitley. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, good. Jeff, tell us about meeting Elizabeth.
Well, we met almost exactly 3 years ago in the Texas Medical Center, where there's something called the Institute for Spirituality and Health. And they were hosting a public event on the near-death experience, which is something, of course, medical professionals see or hear about all the time. And one of my former students helps run the Institute now, a young man named Stuart Nelson. And Stuart asked me to come and respond to this panel. So I actually had no idea what the panel was like. I was just really doing a favor for Stuart, this former student of mine. And we met, the panel met before the session, and then, of course, we had the public event. And I've heard a lot of stories. I study these things professionally, but when I heard Elizabeth's story, I was like, oh, my goodness, you have to tell this story to a bigger audience. You really need to write a book, Elizabeth. And I remember Elizabeth said something to me like, well, I don't know how to write a book. And I said to her, well, I don't have such a story, so maybe the two of us can, you know, do this together. And so it took us a few months to kind of decide we wanted to do that. But certainly by that next January or February, we were pretty much hard at work at the book. And it comes out actually next week. So this is the fruit of 3 years of friendship and conversation, lots of laughing, lots of questions.
But, well, Jeff, I would never think there would be any laughing at all around you.
No, it's really
why don't
all
you tell us? Why don't you tell us a little bit now about Jeff Kripal? And aside from the fact that he and Whitley Strieber have been co-authors of a book together, Supernatural, of which my listeners all know, but tell us about yourself a little bit.
Well, Whitley Strieber calls me the Helen Keller of paranormal research. So I'm not.
Yeah, you were, but you've changed, as you well know, the last time we were at Esalen together.
So I'm a historian of religions, which most people would just translate as someone who compares religion. But what I really do is I work with people's extreme religious experiences and try to make some sense of them in a kind of broad comparative framework. And so Elizabeth's case is a good example of the kinds of things I'm really interested in. I teach at a university, Rice University in Houston, Texas. I've been teaching for over 25 years now. And that's kind of who I am.
And yeah, and you have also published numerous and very important books on these subjects, especially on mythology, in the modern mythology, which is what brought you to an interest in the UFO world in the first place, I think.
Right. I mean, basically what happened was I was actually writing a book on Esalen, this institute in Big Sur, California, that birthed something called the Human Potential Movement. And I was really writing about the history of that place in the counterculture in the 60s and 70s and into today. But as I was working on that project, I kept meeting all of these people whom I got to know quite well. And they were telling me these just outrageous stories of things that just seemed completely impossible to me. But I was convinced they were telling me the truth as best they had it, that these things or something like these things actually happened. And so that was about 07 or 08. And I realized that my own discipline that I'd been trained in, you know, we talk endlessly about myth and folklore and religious experience, but we had completely taken off the table any discussion of these anomalous or paranormal events. And so I set about trying to redress that and to, you know, understand why that had happened, but also get my colleagues to start talking about these things again. And so that's kind of really what I do today is, you know, I go around the country and go around Europe basically begging people to take these things more seriously and put them back on the table so we can really understand who we are and what the heck we're doing here.
Because we, unless we do that, we can't understand who we are. Because as you have pointed out, as Dr. Jacques Vallée has in his book Passport to Magonia and many other books, what we call the UFO phenomenon and alien contact is part of human life and goes back a long ways.
Yeah, I definitely see it in the context of this, you know, millennia-long history of religions where people have been contacting or being contacted by strange beings from the sky for really as far as we can see back.
And it's a huge thing when you think about it, because there are just three incidents in the history of the Western half of the human species: Moses and the burning bush, Paul on the road to Damascus, and Muhammad in the cave, all of whom encountered light, flash of light in the case of Paul, a burning bush, a fiery angel. I mean, a burning bush in the case of Moses, a fiery angel in the case of Muhammad. And these events completely changed the world. So it's not as if this isn't important.
Right.
Right.
It's also not as if this doesn't have something to do with religion.
Now, when we get back, folks, we're going to start talking about another flash altogether. And I would definitely not open an umbrella when you start listening to what happened to Elizabeth. We'll be right back.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, six infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, but not us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years. New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
We're talking to Elizabeth Krohn and Jeff Kripal. Their book, Changed in a Flash, it's out right now. It is just out. And believe you me, this is something. Elizabeth Krohn, tell us a little bit about your life during the time that this event happened. And then we're going to lead up to the event itself.
Okay, Whitley. Well, I really need to start with the time right before the event, because I was really a different person then than I am today. This happened when I was 28 years old, so I was already an adult, but I was a very guarded person and very skeptical about things having to do with the paranormal or really anything out of what I considered at the time to be the ordinary. So then what happened to me was extraordinary and was definitely outside the norm that I was accustomed to. And so it was a very... Pardon my pun here, but it was a very shocking experience, and it was life altering. I was a young mom. I had two young children, a 4-year-old and a 2-year-old, and I was married and just going about my very normal life, and suddenly everything changed.
And you were. You had two boys, is that correct?
I had two boys.
Yes.
Two adorable little boys. Yes.
Who are now adorable big men, hopefully.
Adorable men in their 30s, yes.
Right, exactly. Now, so set the scene for us. I'll start. Elizabeth is going to synagogue with her two boys. Pretty innocent thing to do. What service were you going to, if I may ask?
We were going to every Friday evening. The Jewish people celebrate the Sabbath, and there's a service every Friday evening, and we were going to that service. Now, during the service, they read the names of people that have died during that week in past years. It's like a memorial, kind of. And we were going to services that night because it was going to be the first anniversary of my grandfather's death. So they were going to be reading my grandfather's name. I was not one to go to services very often, but I had been very, very close to my grandfather, and it had been extremely jarring for me when he passed away. And my husband was out of town on business at the time of the service, and so I got my boys dressed for services, and we set off to go to the synagogue.
And then what happened?
And then it had been a beautiful day. It was September 2nd, 1988, and it had been a gorgeous day in Houston. And as soon as we turned into the parking lot at the synagogue, which, by the way, is directly across the street from Rice University, where Jeff has his office, we turned into the parking lot, and this enormous thundercloud came out of nowhere, and rain just started coming down in sheets. There was rain and thunder, and it was a furious storm. And I wasn't prepared for that. It had been a beautiful day, and we were running a little bit late for services because I had on a beautiful new outfit that I had spent way too much money on. And I had insisted on taking a picture of the three of us before we left the house. And because I waited and because I took that picture, it made us a little bit late for services. And so I parked the car, and it was really, really storming. And I told my four-year-old, his name is Jeremy, I told him to get out of the car and run to the awning over the door of the building. And I helped him unbuckle his car seat, and he got out, and I watched him run to the awning, and he made it just fine. And then I climbed over the seat into the back to get my two-year-old, Andy, out of his car seat and got him out. And I opened the car door and kind of struggled between Andy and my umbrella and getting everything ready. And then I stepped out into the storm. And I knew that if I tried to carry Andy and hold the umbrella, we were both going to be absolutely soaked. So I set Andy down, and I knew it was going to take us longer to walk to the building, but if he was walking instead of my carrying him, but I didn't want to carry him. So I put him down, I held his left hand with my right hand, and I had my umbrella in my left hand. And I put my hand very high up on the umbrella shaft and pulled the umbrella down very close to my head. And we set off across the parking lot. And we had maybe taken, I don't know, four or five steps. And suddenly the air seemed to get cooler. It was almost like there was a sudden chill in the air. And I glanced at my hand holding the umbrella, and I thought, this is really not a good idea. I probably should not be holding a collapsible lightning rod in my hand as I'm walking across this flat parking lot in a rainstorm. But before I could do anything about it, there was a bolt of lightning and a very tiny tine of the lightning, a little tiny branch, came off and touched the tip of my umbrella. And that did not knock me out right away, but what it did do was to paralyze my arm and my hand, and I couldn't release my grip on the umbrella. And it was, all of this was going through my mind quickly, very, you know, almost instantly. And the thought even went through my mind that this is really, really bad because my wedding ring is touching the metal shaft of the umbrella. And I believe that was my last thought before the big bolt hit the top of the umbrella and I was knocked out. And so that happened. I know that there had been that tiny tine first and then a larger bolt, because there had been someone there that saw it happen aside from four-year-old Jeremy. There was a man there that had seen it happen, and he told me later. But anyway, the large bolt struck, and I was knocked out. But I didn't realize that. I wasn't aware that I had been knocked out. I thought I was still walking toward the building holding Andy's hand. I couldn't understand why Andy was screaming. He was, and screaming is putting it very mildly. He was, it was horrible, horrible yelling. And we later found out it's because his eardrums had burst and he was in a lot of pain. And I watched as Jeremy ran back out to where we were standing and took his brother by the hand and started pulling him toward the building. And Jeremy was also screaming. And I was following them into the building. And we got inside the lobby, the three of us, and both the boys were just wailing, wailing. And I was standing there, and a man, services had already begun, and a man was walking back toward services from the restroom. And he came over to the boys to try to figure out why they were screaming, which I thought was kind of odd because I was standing right there and, you know, I don't know why he thought he had to come over and talk to them when I was standing right there. But he did. He came over and tried to figure out why they were screaming. And meanwhile, I was beginning to wonder where my umbrella was because I knew I had had it in my hand. So I looked back out the window in the door of the lobby there, and I saw my umbrella, only it was a skeleton of an umbrella, and it was smoking. And my gaze shifted to the right, and about 20 feet from the smoking umbrella, I saw a heap on the ground, just a lifeless heap. And I realized it was me, that I was looking at myself out there on the ground. And it's a little humorous now to look back on this.
Well, wait, let's just back up for a second.
Okay. Stop me anytime.
That's okay.
I get going on this.
It's absolutely fascinating because, folks, let's summarize right now what exactly has happened here. There has been a lightning strike, and it has knocked Elizabeth senseless. She's lying on the ground. Her little two-year-old who was with her has had his eardrums blown out. He is screaming. She is aware of the fact that he is screaming. She has continued on into the synagogue with no awareness at all that she is no longer in the physical state. And we're going to go on deeper into this amazing story in just a moment for our free Dreamlanders. We'll be right back. Are you a close encounter witness? Then Free has something to offer you, and it is absolutely free. Listen as Free organizer Ray Hernandez explains what is available.
The Dr. Edgar Mitchell Foundation for Research into Extraterrestrial Encounters, or FREE, is a not-for-profit academic research institute established by the late Apollo astronaut Dr. Edgar Mitchell, Harvard astrophysicist Dr. Rudy Shield, and various PhD scientists and lay researchers. FREE is researching what is consciousness. In other words, what is the true nature of our multidimensional reality? By undertaking cross-comparative research on individuals that are having various types of contact with non-human intelligence. To participate in FREE's research study and to learn more about their various support and educational programs, please visit their website at experiencer.org. That is experiencer.org. Thank you.
We're talking to Elizabeth Krohn and Jeffrey Kripal. Their fascinating and absolutely amazing new book, Changed in a Flash, One Woman's Near-Death Experience and Why a Scholar Thinks It Empowers Us All. And when we finish with Elizabeth's story, which is this is just the beginning, folks. I know this story. I know Elizabeth. Well, I asked Jeff, just what does he mean by empowerment here? Because this show is about empowering us to explore areas we are told to ignore. So now you have just turned around. You see the heap. The heap is you. Take us back to that moment.
Well, one of the first things I noticed was that the soles of my shoes were blown off, and the bottom of my feet were burned. And there I was standing in the lobby looking out at this scene, and I was upset about the shoes because they had been brand new. It was my first time wearing them. And I thought, they're ruined. They're ruined. So, but how can that be? And I looked down at my feet in the lobby where I was, and the shoes were fine. They were on my feet, and they were perfectly intact. But the odd thing was, my feet weren't touching the ground. I was hovering a few inches off the ground. And to say I was confused is an understatement. This was so disorienting. I can't even begin to tell you. Especially for someone with my background, my history. I mean, growing up, this was so foreign to me. And then in college, I studied business. I mean, it doesn't get much drier than business.
You were a typical secular person.
Yes. Yes,
who did
exactly.
not have any access to anything remotely like this in your life.
Correct.
Never had an OBE, lucid dreaming, any of that. Not interested in spiritual stuff?
No, not at all. So,
here you are standing in the foyer of the synagogue with no body. What do you do?
So, the man that had stopped to try to help my boys must have realized what was going on, and he ran into the sanctuary where services were going on, and he said from the back of the room, I need a doctor. And this is a major, major, huge synagogue here in Houston, and it's a block or two from the Texas Medical Center, which is enormous. So about 40 men got up and rushed toward the back of the room when he asked for a doctor. So I realized that my boys were going to be taken care of. I knew my family was at services for my grandfather's memorial, and there were doctors there. So I knew they were going to be okay,
let's stop here now. At what moment did you realize that you were dead? Or were no longer in your
yet.
Body, I should say.
I didn't realize that yet. I still was unaware of that. At that point, I decided to go back outside and see why I wasn't getting up. And so I
and
floated
so here,
back.
Here, well, I'm sorry to keep interrupting you, Elizabeth. Mm-hmm. I apologize. But here you are. You know you're lying there. And you're mm-hmm. and you're trying to go see why you aren't getting up. It still hasn't occurred to you that something unusual has happened. It just seems normal, doesn't it?
It does.
See, very important, folks, because I had that experience with Annie when she passed away. She was just it felt totally normal to her, and she said a fascinating thing at one point. She said, "It seems like all of you are intentionally ignoring us." Do you? I think you would resonate with that, wouldn't you?
Absolutely.
So
I could not understand why I was being ignored.
Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
So this is the verisimilitude in my mind. She's having the same exact experience that Annie did, with the difference that, as it turned out, differently. But let's go on. Tell the story.
So I went back out into the parking lot. I floated back over to where my body lay on the ground, and I was willing myself to get up. I kept thinking, get up, get up. You're never going to get the stains out of your suit. Get up. And then it hit me. Oh, I'm not getting up because I'm dead. That was the first moment I realized I was dead. And I thought, okay, my next thought was, well, you know what to do. You've done this before. And what I meant by that was when I had been a child, from the time I was 6 years old until I was 12, I had been sexually abused, molested, raped by a babysitter, by a teenage babysitter that we had. And each time he would molest me, I would leave my body. I kind of trained myself. It was just too painful to lie there and take it. So I left. And this is when I was 6 years old. And I became very adept at leaving and then coming back when it was over. And so here I was out in this parking lot, and I thought, well, you don't have to lie here and take it. You can leave. So I did. I left. There was a light. It wasn't a definite form. It was like the light around the sun. It was to my right and up. And I knew that, and it was moving. And I knew that this light wanted me to follow it. So I said, fine, I'm out of here. And I followed this light. And it led me to what I call a garden. However, it is not like any garden here on Earth. It was absolutely, Whitley, the words don't exist here to describe the beauty of this place. That's not the only thing that was indescribable. The most overwhelming thing about this garden when I got there was this feeling of unconditional love. And it was all-consuming. It was all I could think about. It was everywhere. It was around me. It was in me. It was everything, this unconditional love. And a voice said to me, it told me to sit down. And there was a bench there, a garden bench, beautiful, beautiful garden bench, looked like a throne. And so I sat. The voice was that of my grandfather, whose service we had been there to hear. Looking back on it, even then, I knew it wasn't actually my grandfather. But it was God. It was God using my grandfather's voice so as to put me at ease and to keep me from being scared. And it worked. It worked beautifully. I was not the least bit scared. I was so comforted and at peace and happy and content. And what happened from that point forward was basically a download of information that was just put straight into my head. Just, it wasn't something that happened over time. Time in this place was not linear. Time was, something else. It didn't work there the way it works here. Our perception of time here is that it is linear. Things move along on this line, but that is not the way it worked there. Everything was happening at once. All of the information was given at once. Looking back on it, I think I have to remember it in linear terms, or I can't decipher it. It's too much all at once. So looking back, I remember it in linear terms, but it didn't happen that way. I would swear that I was there for 2 weeks. But here on Earth, I was out on the ground in the parking lot for maybe 2 minutes. So, and there's no way to get the amount of information that I got in 2 minutes. So.
But it turned out to be an incredible whatever amount of time it was. It was, as you say, a different time. But then again, Jeff, this business of distortion of time is very commonplace in these experiences, isn't it? But before you answer, wait a minute. I have just realized we've come to one of those magic moments. Free Dreamlanders, we'll be right.
Whitley Strieber is the legendary author of Communion, Transformation, The Grays, Superstorm with Art Bell, and so many more. You can find out more on his author website, Strieber.com. Get his great new Journey to Dog Heaven, his classics, The Wolfen, Transformation, rarities like The Wild, and so many more. Strieber.com. And join Whitley on his Facebook group, Supernatural. Follow him on Twitter, Whitley Strieber, author of Wonder.
All right, Jeff, this distortion of time goes way back into the fairy lore and so forth, and it's in fact happens in lives, as both of you know. It happened in my life a year ago May. Go ahead.
Well, time in the history of religions is very interesting, because we tend to think of time in the secular world as, you know, basically a straight linear arrow, but much of religious practice and religious belief is about some other kind of time that, as Elizabeth said, is all at once. And this is, by the way, is what most theologians meant by eternity in the Christian tradition. Eternity is not, or was not, some long, long, long time. It was some state of being in which there was no linear time. Everything was happening or is happening all at once. So, you know, it makes a lot of sense that she would enter such a state of time, because, again, that's very faithful to these earlier religious notions.
Go ahead.
Well, the other thing I'll say is, you know, one of the most common religious practices on the planet, really universally distributed, is divination, is the attempt to somehow access some future event or some piece of knowledge from the future, so that we can respond better to it or be ready for it. And of course, that implies that the future already exists. This, in fact, is essentially what Elizabeth experienced as well. So, again, it fits into this broader picture.
Well, of course, we're going to have Eric Wargo on Dreamland shortly with his show, his book, Time Loops. And he will be talking about this very thing, as to whether or not there is what physicists call a block universe. In other words, where everything is already set, kind of like it's a gigantic kind of a jewel, or if it allows change. It's a really interesting question, though, because from Elizabeth's standpoint, Elizabeth was still incredibly beautiful, wasn't it?
Oh, it was incredibly beautiful, indescribable. Yeah.
Now, so here you are in this place, in this indescribable, beautiful place, and you know you're dead.
Mm-hmm.
But you also know some other things about those two little boys. Can you tell us what went through your mind at that point?
Well, I was given a choice. I was told that I could stay there forever. I could follow a path that was there that led into a mountain range, and beyond the mountains I could see the light that I had followed there. And I was told that if I decided to stay, that's where I would go, beyond the mountains, or I could choose to go back. And that I would be given information to help me make the decision, and I could ask whatever questions I wanted. So I proceeded to ask questions about my children and my family and my life. And I was told that if I decided to go back, I would be giving birth to a third child, a girl, a daughter, and that she had in fact already selected me as her mother and my husband as her father. And that, in that instant, I understood reincarnation. I had never given it a second thought in the first 28 years of my life. But in that instant, I suddenly knew that it's a reality, and I understood how it worked. And I was told also that if I decided to come back, I would be facing a divorce at some point in the future, because I would be coming back as a different person. And my husband would still be the same person he had always been, yet I was somebody completely different. And I had a hard time believing that, because we were very happy. You know, our little growing family, and my husband had a good business, and it we were happy. There was no reason to think that we might get divorced. But I thought, you know, if there's even a slight possibility, I need to go back, because I need to be the one raising the children, not him. And so I decided to come back. And I was told that I would have a lot of physical pain if I decided to come back, because I was burned, and also because my soul had to be squeezed back into my body, and that was a painful process, I was told. The soul had expanded much larger than my body, and he was going to have to squeeze me very tight. He said, it will feel like your bones are being crushed, and to get me back into my body. And that's what happened. That's exactly what happened. I was put back into my body, and I opened my eyes lying on the ground in the parking lot in the rain. And people had just started to come out to help me.
And so, there you were, and you ended up having all that pain in the hospital.
I did have the burns on my feet were very painful. I was pretty much bedridden for about 3 months, because it was walking was a real chore. So the first 3 months or so, I spent most of my time in bed. And that's when I started realizing I had these new abilities, I guess you would call them. It was certainly nothing that I had before. I started realizing that I knew things before they happened. And I didn't talk about this with anyone. I was really afraid of what people's reaction would be. I knew what my reaction would have been had someone told me this back then. And so I wasn't real anxious to have people respond to me that way. So I kept it pretty much to myself. I would have these, I guess you'd call them premonitions of things that were going to happen. And sometimes I would tell my husband, I would tell my mom sometimes, and then they would happen the next day or within the next week or so. And it was really unnerving, and it took me a while to realize I needed to somehow document the fact that I knew these things before they happened. And this was only to prove it to myself. I never thought anybody else would see anything that I wrote. So it wasn't until 2008 that I realized I could email myself these nightmares that I would have, and then they would be date and time stamped. And then if the event happened, I would have proof to myself that I did in fact know about it before it happened. So that's what I started doing. And my husband and I did in fact get divorced about 9 years after my near-death experience. I did have a daughter 2 years after my near-death experience. And everything I was told in the garden came to pass. Everything. And I was told a lot. Everything was very accurate.
We're going to get into the psychic stuff in a moment, because folks, from personal experience, I can assure you that Elizabeth is one of the most powerful psychics I know. But something else started to happen. And Jeff, what I would like to do now is for you to let us know what Elizabeth began to report to you in regard to her dreams.
Well, basically what happened after the lightning strike was that she began to have nightmares, very vivid nightmares, of things like plane crashes and tsunamis and earthquakes that would then mysteriously play out in the next day news. One of the first of these was the San Francisco earthquake of 1989, fall of 1989, the day before which she dreamed of this very clear image of a policeman standing over an immense crack in the sidewalk. And she became very concerned about her family members who lived in San Francisco. And sure enough, the earthquake struck. And that very image then appeared in the newspapers a day or so later. So she began to have these nightmares, and she also began to have intuitions about different people who had died or were about to die. And essentially, this was all very troubling and very unwelcome to her. And she, you know, struggled with this for years until email came on the scene, and she decided to begin sending herself time-stamped emails about these nightmares so that she would have some timestamp and some proof that essentially she wasn't going crazy when these events later happened. So there was a whole kind of paranormal after effect or aftermath of her lightning strike that is really quite extraordinary. And of course, it wasn't limited to the nightmares. It involved all sorts of things. It involved a kind of sensitivity to electricity. It involved a haunted necklace. It involved her ability to sort of psychically read people. I mean, she became a kind of prodigy after this event.
In a prodigy in what sense?
Well, a kind of a paranormal or psychical prodigy that she, you know, now she had capacities and abilities that before, she didn't have, and B, she actually made fun of when she encountered these claims in other people.
Yeah, tell us a little bit about that, Elizabeth.
Well, I never made fun of anyone to their face. But this type of thing, this is why it's so ironic that this happened to me, or maybe it's not ironic, maybe it's all by design. But, you know, before this happened, if somebody told me that they could know the future, I wouldn't have made fun of them to their face, but I definitely would have gone home and told my husband, and we would have had a big laugh about it. And now here it was happening to me, and I couldn't tell my husband about it because he still thought it was a joke. He thought it was a joke. And so anyway, that did speed up the demise of our marriage. And so, you know, Jeff and I didn't talk very much about this, but I've often wondered if this may have happened to me because of the type of person I had been before. I don't know. Maybe if it had happened to somebody who already understood all of this, it wouldn't have been as impactful as it was on me.
Because it's impossible for a person who has lived with the idea that there is nothing more than this world to look beyond. I know very well how you feel. But Jeff, she began to, at one point after you met, and this was years later, to email you when she had these, had precognitive dreams. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I asked her to do that. And so she began doing this, you know, as we were finishing the book, actually. I remember one of them very distinctly. One of them involved the tragic plane crash down in South America that involved the soccer team, in which the entire soccer team was, almost the entire soccer team was killed. And one of the things I remember so well about it is she sent me actually a series of emails through the night. The first one basically said, I just had this nightmare. This plane has gone down. It had an athletic team on it. I don't recall if she placed it in South America, but I think she did. And then she sent me another. Now, I was asleep during all this, so I'm reading these the next day. Then she sent me another email and a couple hours later saying, oh, never mind, ignore all that. It turns out that the crash happened before my dream. So apparently the news cycle had just reported it sometime early in the morning. And I asked Elizabeth, I said, well, Elizabeth, did you know that the plane had gone down before you went to bed? And she said, no, of course not. So she was willing to discount essentially this clairvoyant dream simply because it wasn't clearly precognitive. It happened after the actual event, but it happened before the media event that she would have accessed later that morning. So, to me, that was a real clue what was going on.
But Elizabeth, tell us what you did experience, because this is a really extraordinary story.
Well, actually, yes, Jeff, I did say that it happened in South America. At the time, I had a stepson that was living in Bogota. And so I was very clear that it had happened or was going to happen in South America, either had happened or was going to happen. Yeah. And I knew that it was a crash that I knew that several people were going to survive, but that most of the people on the plane were going to be killed. And I sent Jeff the email. And I guess I had a hard time going back to sleep, and I was playing around on the internet and trying to get tired enough to go back to sleep. I sent him the original email at 1:52 a.m. And it must have been maybe 2 hours later. I started seeing reports of this plane crash, and it was near Medellin, Colombia. And there was this soccer team on board, and it was exactly what I had dreamt. But it had happened earlier. It happened before 1:52 a.m. Houston time. So I sent Jeff another email, and I said, just disregard the last email because it was not precognitive. I mean, I didn't know about it. It happened after I had already gone to bed, but it had not happened. It happened before I sent the email. And Jeff came back and he said, just because it wasn't precognitive doesn't mean that it wasn't clairvoyant. It was. And it is kind of sad that somebody would discount,
yeah,
myself, would discount this event because it happened before I emailed myself about it.
Well, go ahead.
Whitley, if I can jump in here, you know, for your listeners, that's talking about the future, when you speak to Eric Wargo, so, you know, to me, this is a perfect Eric Wargo example, because as I thought more about this case, I became convinced that actually her dream was precognitive. But it wasn't precognitive of the crash itself. It was precognitive of her witnessing this news story on the media a few hours later. So I think she was precognizing seeing the news item about the crash, even though the crash had taken place for the dream, if that makes sense. And of course, yeah. this is what Eric thinks about right. precognition in general, as you know.
Yeah, well, our listeners haven't yet heard Eric, so they will shortly. But
yeah, there's a kind of teaser for what is to come, as it were.
Right. Elizabeth, there was another plane crash in which you actually were on the plane at one point in the OBE state.
Right.
Tell us about that.
So that one is actually, we did not talk about in our book because there are surviving family members, and I just felt like it wasn't the right thing to do. I didn't want to talk about their deceased relatives. But what happened was there was a plane. I don't even want to mention what airline it was, but I was having this dream that turned into a nightmare that I was on this plane, and I was sitting on a tray table facing a passenger, facing a woman, and we were talking. We were making small talk. It was like we were at a cocktail party or something, and she's a very pretty woman, and she was introducing me to her son, who was sitting next to her, little five-year-old boy sitting next to her. And I said, well, it's nice to meet you. And he was sitting there playing with one of those little handheld electronic, like a Game Boy type thing. And then the plane started to go down, and people were screaming on the plane, and this woman grabbed my forearms, and she wouldn't let go, and she was begging me to take her son. She knew, and I knew, that I could leave the plane. All I had to do was open my eyes, and I wouldn't be on that plane. And she somehow knew that, and she wanted me to take her son with me, which I couldn't do. I couldn't do it. But I also was struggling to open my eyes because somehow the fact that she had a grip on my arms was not allowing me to open my eyes and wake up. And finally, just before the plane hit the water, I opened my eyes. And there were two notable things about this nightmare that made it different from my others. The first was that I was on the plane, and that has not happened since, and it had not happened before. The second thing is I remembered her name and her son's name, and both of those names were in the email that I sent myself. And about 3 days later, they printed a manifest, a list of all the passengers in the newspaper. And sure enough, there it was, her name and her son's name. And they are not even American. I mean, I absolutely did not know these people.
Yeah, it was a French plane that went down and disappeared for months. No one could find it.
Right, right. And so her name, and she had told me while I was on the plane visiting with her, she had told me that, you know, this is my son, and told me his name. And she said, I also have a daughter, but she and my husband took a different flight because we never fly together as a family, just in case. And sure enough, the husband and the daughter survived and have gone on with their lives. And
So did you contact the husband and daughter?
No. Recently, this happened many years ago, but recently I looked on Facebook and I found him. And he's not American, but I found him on Facebook, and I saw that he had just recently gotten remarried and saw a picture of their daughter, you know, the woman that died. Her daughter, and I did not contact him I mean, it would have been easy enough, I guess, to send a Facebook message, but why? I guess it was a real moral dilemma for me. I didn't see any upside to it into upsetting his life at this point. I mean, the man's been through a lot, and you know, he's remarried. He's trying to move on with a new life, and I didn't contact him.
So here we are. You have had this life and are having it. Mm-hmm. You have, in my case, but sadly enough, folks, it's too personal. Elizabeth has been part of one of the most extraordinary, I guess, media mystic experiences I've ever known in my life. She and another psychic have duplicated each other's psychic hits on something that was happening to me. And without even knowing that each other existed, they weren't even in the, they don't even know each other at all. And so something very powerful and extraordinary here. Elizabeth and Jeff have written a beautiful book, Changed in a Flash. I've looked on Amazon and seen some of the fairly dopey reviews, but you know, they're basically from people who are, like most of us, they're disempowered. They don't see it. Apparently it was sent as a free copy to a lot of people who are very much in the conventional secular world. So just ignore them, folks. And if you read it and like it, do give it a review that it deserves, because it deserves excellent reviews. This is a true story. I know it to be true because I know these people so well. And it is powerful. And if you want to get a hold of Elizabeth and Jeff, just write Whitley@Strieber.com and I'll send your email along if you'd like to talk to them or engage with them with your own stories. Now, I would like to end, before we say goodbye, with one thing. And this is not completely off the wall, but it's close. A few months ago, my implant flashed past the date, October the 19th, 2018. This show starts on October the 19th, 2018. And I've already documented with quite a few people that date. It's seemingly a coincidence that this show starts on that date, but it will be very interesting if something else happens on that date tomorrow as we are recording this, and you will be listening to it on Friday or after. Thank you both very much for being with us. Changed in a Flash.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.